Welcome to another inspiring message with Pastor Deborah Bell from Deo Gloria, South Africa, as she brings you a word from God.
The enemy has been defeated, and death couldn't hold you down. We're gonna lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud. The enemy has been defeated, and death couldn't hold you down. We're gonna lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud.
Shout out to God.
Shout out to God with the voice of triumph. Shout out to God with the voice of praise. Shout out to God with the voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout out to God with the voice of triumph. Shout out to God with the voice of praise. Shout out to God with the voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up.
And there is an egging on this morning. There is an encouragement this morning coming from Holy Spirit. There is an encouragement this morning coming from Holy Spirit. Egging you on this morning, saying, come on, I know that you can make it. No matter what you've been through this past year, you can make it. You can cross that finishing line. It doesn't matter what's come in your path. It doesn't matter how discouraged the enemy has made you. It doesn't matter what has fallen over in your midst that you didn't expect, whether it be death or grief or whatever you've had to encounter. Know this, that God is greater. Know this, that nothing can take away your destiny. Nothing can take away your future. Nothing can take away your purpose. Nothing can just don't let the enemy rent that space in your head, because God has already ordained it for greater things. Hallelujah. So the Lord is egging you on this morning. The Lord is saying, no matter what has fallen in your path, no matter what has distracted you, no matter what has caused you to shift, no matter what has caused you to lose hope, God this morning is about to release upon you a new hope. God is about to release upon you that which you've been calling on the Lord for. God is about to, why do you think these things happen at the 11th hour? Just as the promises and prophetic words of God come and happen at the 11th hour, so too, understand this and know that those utterances that come at the 11th hour, so too, often do we find these bad experiences happen at the 11th hour. They happen when we least expect it. They happen when we wouldn't even know. They happen when we can't even understand it. But I'm telling you now that you must take hold of that. And you must say, you know what, I'm going to hold on to James 1 and 2. Because I'm believing that no matter what my trial is, nothing can separate me from the plan of God. Nothing can separate me from the purposes of God. Unless I give up. Unless I give up in my mind. Unless I give up in my spirit. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we started to sing. We started to sing and we sang. We sang that song. We sang. We sang. Come on, come on, come on. We sang, whoa, whoa, whoa. I know I can make it. Come on, come on. I know we can make it. How many of you have ever been to a race? And you've experienced that you're not at the finishing line. You know, but you're closer to the finishing line than you are to the starting line. Come on. How many know that that's the place where the crowds gather? Because that's where all the excitement happens. Some are there because they want to see people like kind of, you know, just, whoa, this is so exciting. Will they make it or won't they? So they're there for the adrenaline rush because they're not on the field. They're not in the race. Hallelujah. You're always going to get those kind of people. Listen to me now. You're going to get the people that stand there skeptics saying, I wonder if she or he is going to finish this race. Let me talk to my partner in crime. I don't think so. Oh, no. Look at her. She can't even. She's stumbling. She's crawling there. She's not going to make it to the finish line. Never. Let's take a bet. What about him? Look at him over there. He looks like he could finish, but you know what? I'm not quite sure. It's easy for those people that are standing on the sidelines to to look at your race and comment on your race if they're not in it. But they haven't run in your running shoes. Hallelujah. Then you get the others, and these are the ones that I like. The ones that are not in the race, but they're standing around you and they're supporting you. And they're saying, come on, come on. It's just a little bit further. It just, you just have to just take a few more steps and you're going to cross that line. Don't give up. And they're standing there on the sideline and they're cheering you on. Those are the kind of people I like in my life. They're saying, and it's not false hope. It's not like, oh, you can make it, but you can't really. We all know that. We can't in our own strength. Not the race of life. We can run many other races and win in our own strength, whether it be athletic races or whatever. But when it comes to the race of life, you need Jesus Christ. Friends, you need Jesus Christ. Some of us have been running and we don't understand why we're so tired, and it's because we've taken the long way round. I'm preaching to someone this morning. What do I mean the long way around? I mean, we're on the road and we're running and we're exhausted and we're wondering, where's everybody? And then we can see people in the distance. That long way round is courses of actions that we take when we divert from the path of God. And that road is lonely. There's very few that cheer you on that road. That's why that road is not like backsliding fully or anything, but it's like moving out of the plan of God. You move out of that covering, out of that encouragement, out of that place of hope, because it's such a lonely road. And then it takes so much more effort to get back. And so many people get so exhausted they just can't make it back. And they just give up hope, and the enemy's already got a stronghold because they're out there alone on that road. And so he brings in the crowds that will say to that person, just the few, you can't make it. Don't even try. Just give up right now. What's the point? Those of you that want to give up, leave right now. Leave this house right now. If you want to give up, if you don't believe what I'm saying, leave. Either you believe what I'm saying is true or it's not. And if it's not true, why are we still here? You are here and I am here because we believe in a hope that is much greater than ourselves. Because we understand that God has given us immense capabilities, amazing intellect, great, wonderful bodies for those of us that look after our bodies the right way. But God's given us so much more than that to sustain us in the race of life. And that is Holy Spirit. That's the fire and glory of God in our lives that helps us to keep hope where there is no hope. That helps to sustain us through the struggles, through the difficult times, through our grief, through our financial difficulties. All of those things. But friends, we've got to move into Romans 12:2 and we've got to turn it around. What do I mean? Turn with me in your Bibles to Romans 12:2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Amen? So we've got to offer everything, including our bodies. Verse 2, do not conform. Here's the formula. Do you want to know what the formula is for your race? Do you want a quick formula? For life, you know, people say there's no quick fixes. No. But there are some very clear formulations that God gives us in the Word. Our part is not in hearing them. Our part is in doing them. Amen. Amen. And so here it is in verse 2. Here's what God gives us. Here is the advice from heaven. This is what God put into the spirit of Paul, and this is what he wrote. Do not conform, read it with me, to the pattern of this world. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You see, when our mind is in right alignment with Holy Spirit, with God, we are able to clearly discern what the will of God is for our lives. If you don't believe me, read the next sentence. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. God's good, pleasing and perfect will. Does it say God's terrible brimstone and fire will for your life? No. It says then you'll be able to test and approve what God's good, pleasing will is. God's will is goodness for us. It's not doom and gloom. God never intended you and I to be in a place of lack. God didn't intend the church to be in a place of lack. God didn't intend... Listen, if there's going to be money floating around, let it be with the children of God, so that, because then hopefully we have got the mind of Christ to disperse that as believers into the right places. Hallelujah. Because we're good stewards with 100% of what we have, right? So everything we have, we will disperse according to the will of God. God wants me to put money there, I put it there. Whether I think I'm high and dry or not, I obey God. Because I understand the principle of obedience always brings forth blessing. Always. That's the principle. Even with Elijah, you'll see in the story, always obedient. Look, if you want to be blessed, obey. Simple rule. But here's the thing about Romans 12. One can preach 150 different sermons on this. The point is that the way that you and I finish the race is to not conform to the thinking of the world, but to allow our minds to be transformed. Not because you've got positive thinking, because that... You can go and do as many of those courses as you like, and they will help you in many areas of your life. But there's only one who can help you finish the race of life and to finish it well. And by the way, that was the topic for the next sermon that I was going to preach to you on. It was about how to finish well. Looks like God's got some other plans of leading me into that. But the point is, and there's the scripture you can look at where it says how we run the race, and you know, we run not just to get, there's not just one crown, but we know that we run for so much more than that. There's a glory that awaits all of us. God wants to bestow upon you a crown of glory. The Isaiah 61 says God has taken the ashes and he's given you beauty. God's given you beauty for ashes. Yet the enemy still got some of your minds living in the ashes. You're scrounging in the ashes. Don't scrounge in the ashes anymore. Turn around and say, listen, there's a crown on my head. Get behind me, Satan. Come on. You know what? The thing with us is not so much being saved. I preached on this at Sozo, and it was because it was a preceding sermon for what was to come. Because the place that the enemy attacks people is their minds. And yet it's the last thing that comes into alignment with God. We get our spirits into alignment, but our minds are the things that have to come into alignment. Because when the going gets tough, that's the place where the decisions are made. And that goes into your spirit being and overrides every part of your flesh. What is in your flesh? The area of the soul? That's where fear resides and those things that have now you've been delivered from, right? Amen. And if you haven't been delivered from those things, come up for prayer this morning. Let God heal you in those areas. Because your decision making must always be from a transformed mind. Amen? So let me tell you why that's so important. Because otherwise, you will see things the wrong way. You're going to see things from a worldly perspective. When you conform to the pattern of this world, you will see things from a worldly perspective. Does that make sense? Is anybody with me this morning? But when you conform to the Holy Spirit, when you allow yourself to be transformed and your mind is renewed, then what you're conforming to, then what you subscribe to is not the pattern of this world. In other words, you are not moved or shifted by the things that happen in your life. Do they affect you? Of course. You know, do they challenge your emotions? Of course. Of course, people. But they don't dictate the decisions that you make. And for you and I, we've got to move into places where we know for sure that the decisions we make, that we're growing, that we're mature in the Lord, that the decisions we make are ones that come from the transformed mind, the renewing of our minds. I appeal to you, therefore, brethren and sisterin, and I beg of you, in view of all the mercies of God, to make a decisive dedication of your bodies. Notice it's decisive. That decision-making is yours. Presenting all your members and faculties as a living sacrifice, holy, devoted, consecrated, and well-pleasing to God, which is your reasonable, rational, intelligent service and spiritual worship. Do not, read it with me, do not be conformed to this world, this age, fashioned after and adapted to its external, superficial customs, but be transformed, changed by the entire renewal of your mind, by its new ideals and its new attitude, so that you may prove for yourselves what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God, even the thing which is good and acceptable and perfect in God's sight for you. See, when your mind is transformed and in alignment, then you will be fully in alignment with the will of God. So often people don't understand. They say, gee whiz, how can that person fall off the bus? Because their spirit was somewhat aligned, but their mind hadn't been transformed. See, I'll tell you what inhibits us from transforming our minds. I can't tell you this enough. I've preached on it till I'm blue in the face, but many of you will understand. Fear is a huge inhibitor of transforming our minds. You know, it sounds weird, but sometimes we fear letting go of the old. Sometimes it takes people years to let go of the fears of the past, or the things that have captured them in fear. Amen? Are you with me? That's just one simple, I'm not trying to establish a psychological thing. I'm not a psychologist. I'm just explaining it to you from a pastoral point of view and a biblical perspective and with a spiritual understanding that I know. It's so difficult to explain. But that is part of the problem, because when you are kept, when there are pockets, let me put it this way, when there are pockets in the area of your soul, pockets that haven't been transformed, that haven't been renewed, there are strongholds that come out of the camp of the enemy that are still from the old flesh that reside there. And at the opportune time, just as the scriptures in the Gospels talk about how the enemy would come back at an opportune time to Jesus, the King of Kings, and tempt him, do you really think he's not going to come to you and I at an opportune time? So when you are high in the sky in the Spirit of the Lord, and you are on cloud 10, and you are moving and you are grooving and you felt the presence of God and there's been prophetic word over your life and you've got the new job and you've got the wonderful wife or husband and all of those things are going well, that's not the time the enemy will come. When things start going wrong in your life and you are down, that's when he comes, because he's a coward, so he kicks you on the ground. Whoops. The reason he's kicking so many people on the ground right now is because he's on the ground. He's on his back. He's on his back struggling like this because he knows what is to come. The question is, do you and I know what is to come? The question is, are our minds transformed to the point where we are ready for what God wants to do in our lives, and that we are not distracted or phased out by conforming to the things of the world? How do you know where you are in your spirit being regarding transformation? You need to ask yourself, am I conforming to the pattern of this world? In other words, is my decision-making being made according to the pattern of this world, or is it coming from a transformed mind that is looking to the things that are above the threshold, the things that go beyond, the things that are not seen, the things that are unseen, the patterns that are formed in the heavens, the prophetic words that have been poured into my life? You see, we are forgetters that need to be made rememberers. That's why there was the festival of booths in the Old Testament, because the Israelites so quickly forgot what God did in their lives. So quickly we seem to be those that forget the great and wonderful miracles that God does in our lives. Amen? I'm telling you the truth here. They had been taken into the desert with nothing. God not only parted the waters and blacked out the sea so that the enemies were slain and did that miracle, but manna was given to them every single day and they began to grumble. We want meat. We're tired of this manna. It's a season of fresh manna to come upon us. That's what Revelation 2 is about. God's given us that white stone with a new name. Do you remember? Your name is Hephzibah. God has called you by a new name. You are God's delight, remember? So why on earth would God wish bad things to come upon you? Now, many of you heard prophets speak about a sermon a couple of weeks ago called Your Turnaround Is Here, something to that effect, right? And the reason why I originally called this sermon, which was, where is it? There it is. Thank you. Turn It Around. It's not because I haven't got another name for my message. It's because we work together in sync with the Spirit. And what God was showing me was Joshua 24:15, which we're going to come to in a minute. But the point is that for you and I, my friends, it doesn't matter what's gone before us. Many of you had a very difficult 2014. Put your hand up if you've not had a difficult 2014. If nothing has gone wrong. Okay, now I want you to do something for me. Spend just about 30 seconds and try and remember the great things that God has done in your life, even miraculous events. Come on. Just spend 30 seconds. Close your eyes. 30 seconds. Think about things, events, jobs, finances, times when prayers were answered in your life. How many of you have remembered something? I'm not gonna ask you, but just put your hands up. Come on, most of you. You see, most of you have put your hands up. But did you see and notice that before I asked you that question, how quickly you had forgotten? Amen? Any amens in the house? Because we get so wrapped up with conforming to the patterns of this world that the enemy keeps so many people busy in their minds with what's going on now that we not only forget the God who helped us in the past, the God who already had established our future in the past. We sit absolutely bogged down by the weight and the magnitude of what faces us that we forget the greatness of our God. And so we start conforming to the patterns of the world. We want to be transformed so that our minds don't revert to the old. So that our minds don't conform to the patterns of the world. When the enemy comes to attack you, when he tries to bring disaster upon your house, when he tries to take from you your family or your job or your whatever it is, you can turn around and you can say there, listen, enemy. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. What does it mean to turn things around? It means to take hold of what you know this word says about your future and not what the world says about your future and not what those that are standing in that lonely road are busy telling you as they stand on the sidelines saying, don't be stupid. Don't believe in all that rubbish. How can God? There's no God of miracles today. And even that little voice, the wrong one, that's saying to you, listen, God's not going to help me out of this. I believe in a God of miracles, but it's not for me. Yeah. Don't let your own self-worth, or lack of self-worth, should I say, inhibit you from being an inheritor of the blessing and the promise. It doesn't even matter what you think of yourself. What matters is what does God say about you? If you're not even at a place to understand or acknowledge or love yourself or you haven't got a revelation or a healing in that area yet, that's okay. But just do one thing for me. Do you believe the word? Do you believe what God says about you? Because if you believe what God says about you, then you can hold on to that and let God do the rest later. But when the enemy comes against you, the formulation is to take hold of the word that you know. And you turn around like Joshua and you say, as for me and my household, we are going to serve the Lord. You can throw anything at me. You can give me a Job experience. You can take me into the deep waters where I can't swim. But I'm telling you, enemy, as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord, the God of hope, the God of mercy, the God of grace, the great I am, because there's nothing that you can do to me that can pull me away from the plans and the grace of the God that I serve. So it doesn't matter what it looks like. I'm not conforming to the pattern of this world. I'm transformed in my thinking. I'm renewed in my mind by the power of Holy Spirit. Because the Bible says that God has given you everything you need to live a life of godliness. Go read 1 Peter. Everything we need, we have through the Spirit and the power of God. And the other day I was saying, Lord, how? Show me the strategy. And the Lord gave me Zechariah 4. It's not by might. It's not by your power. But by my Spirit, says the Lord. By my Spirit. So so many of us, when we get into that place where we've been pulled through the mud in 2014, and I know so many of you have, that's why we've spoken and given so many sermons of deep hope. I mean, a sermon must always have hope. But in the place, I know that people have been stretched. Do you know what our scripture was last year? It was Isaiah 54. It was about enlarging the place of your tent and stretching your tent pegs. That stretching of your tent pegs was the stretching of your faith. Are you with me? When we are able to allow God to stretch our faith, character is built. Amen? Because when you have been through the mill and you've allowed yourself through a renewed mind to be taken through that place of struggle by the power of Holy Spirit, you come out knowing that the God you serve is there for you. But when you give up in the race before you have finished and you just say, I can't do it anymore. Even though people are saying, the finish line is just there, just wait. You never get to see the faithfulness of your God in your life. And that's the objective of the enemy, is to stop you growing your faith, to stop you seeing the faithful one. Here's James. Consider pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking in anything. But so many people stop short of that finish line. And the Bible calls us to finish well. Because God knows what awaits us. God knows the struggles we will endure. But God knows what God has in store for each one of you to grow you into a giant in the spirit. Amen. Just stay. Don't be, you know, I did a sermon. I'm kind of going a little bit everywhere today, but I'm focusing on this race thing because I did a sermon quite a lot of years ago, but yet it's one that seems to have really stuck with all of us. And it was called Stayers, Not Flyers. Does anybody remember that? I'm glad. Stayers, Not Flyers. And I spoke about how a flock of geese fly in a V formation and how they rotate that place at the head. They stick together as they fly. And then as the one grows tired, then they swap. They swap. They keep rotating their roles. And they keep making sure that they protect the flock. It's incredible. And that's how we're supposed to be as the church. Amen. Like the scripture says, when you are weak, you are strong. Because there's always somebody that will take your hand. The problem for you and I is that we get prideful. We don't even want to reach out and say, I need help. We don't even want to say, listen, there's an issue, there's a problem. Amen. Amen. And the thing is that that's when the enemy gets you down, is when you zip your mouth. When you don't talk. When you don't share. Amen. When you're not able to listen, I'm telling you straight, friends, that's a spirit of pride when you cannot share that you're having struggles in your relationship, in your family life, in your finances, in your whatever. We have pastors in this church. We have helpers. Anybody you can come to and say, listen, I need you to pray for me. This is what's going on. Do you know that the moment you break that ice, do you know that you break the silence of the enemy over your life? You actually break because his desire for your life is exposed. So the thing that keeps you from doing it is pride. Oh no, I don't want them to think I'm a bad Christian. You know, if they think I've got problems in my relationship or problems in my finance or problems in my job, they're going to think, you of little faith. No, we're going to think you're a brave person and a mature person for coming for help. Amen. And that's really, really important. And you know, it's so important for you and I to understand the greatness of God in our lives for this hour and this day. Yes. What God wants to do. It's no wonder so many have been through the mill in 2014. We know it was originally the year of doubles, with a 7 and 7 as 14, God's perfect number. But now we say it's the year of double doubles because it's 5, 7, 7, 5, and we know there's two sets of doubles, and we're very prophetic in this church. Amen. And we've seen how the prophets have prophesied over Revelation 4:1. It's come through now in January. Behold, there is an open door before you. Come up here. Yeah. Come up here. After this, I looked, And there before me was a door standing open. Everyone, tell your neighbor, I'm going through an open door. Tell your other neighbor, nothing's going to stop me. Because God goes before me. After this I looked, and there before me was a door standing open in heaven. And the voice I had first heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place. After this, at once, everybody say at once.
At once.
See, the moment you go up there, the moment you move into the spirit realm, it's at once. That's what I preached at one of the conferences. I said, at once, because you move from this earthly realm into the spirit realm by faith at once. It's not that you have to toil in the presence. And at once, when your mind is transformed, you move into that place. And that's the place God wants your mind to be. When trouble strikes, when struggle comes in your way, turn it around. Say, as for me and my household, we're going to serve the Lord. At once I was in the spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it. Now, I want to tell you something. The Lord is calling us to come up here. The Lord is calling us to a new place of refuge. The Lord is saying, when you find these things happening, it's not an escapism to go into your prayer closet. It's not an escapism to move into a place of prayer and believe good things. It's not resolving your issues. Of course, do those things diligently. Be a good steward over your life, over your finances, over your debt, all of those things. But don't you think it's also time that you got faith and you started saying, Lord, I'm canceling this debt. I don't want this debt anymore. I don't want this hump on my back anymore of trouble, of anxiety, of struggle. I'm tired of living like this. How many are tired of what 2014 brought you in the negative sense? How many are saying it's time to turn it around? Tell somebody, I'm turning it around today. It's time. Tell somebody else, God's turning it around for you today. Amen. Now, as an apostle, the prophet will tell you that turnaround is here. As an apostle, I will tell you turnaround is here, but here's what you got to do to get your turnaround. Hallelujah. And so that's why we've been speaking about things like Romans 12:2. Why? Because let me tell you something. If you go to Numbers 13 and 14 and you start reading the story about how the 10 spies, the 10 chiefs went into of the tribes, they went into the promised land to go and explore the land. Remember, they were sent in. And two of those was Joshua and Caleb. And they came back. Two people carried on like a pole. They carried the fruit of the land. Can you imagine how much fruit they brought back? And they reported this. They said in Numbers 13 and 14, you can read it. They came back and they said, hey, listen, guys, this fruit is bellissimo. This fruit is amazing. You got to try. Check this fruit. You can imagine they all checked the fruit. The fruit is good. Listen, when the enemy comes to you, check the fruit. Check the fruit. Because you know what happened? They checked the fruit and everybody agreed. They went, wow, this fruit is amazing. We've never seen anything like it. And you know what they said in their next breath? Everyone except Joshua and Caleb. Joshua, the same one that said, as for me and my household, later on, we will serve the Lord. You know what happened? They all turned around after seeing this beautiful fruit. And they went, oh, but we can't take this land. Have you seen the giants in that land? We just look like grasshoppers. And then the one would give another negative thing. And by the time they were finished, they were like, we can't do that. We're going to get annihilated. Joshua stood up and Caleb and said, surely we can take this land, people. Look at the fruit. We can take it. We can make it. His mindset was transformed. Caleb and Joshua were the only survivors. Do you know they're the only two that entered into the promised land? They're the only ones, all of you know this, they're the only ones that entered into the promised land. Why do you think that was? It wasn't just because they said what God wanted them to say. It was because they had transformed minds. The Bible says that Caleb had a different spirit. Friends, can I share something now, prophetic, apostolic with you? This age we're moving into, this season as we move into this year of 2015, friends, I am telling you, we are a people that have to have a different spirit. God's eyes are looking to and fro for those that have a different spirit. Those that have a spirit like Caleb and Joshua. Those that are able to say, listen, my turnaround is here. Get out of the way, Satan. I've got no time for your nonsense. I have some things to do. I've got some work to do in the kingdom. Hallelujah. Don't get put off and disappointed because you haven't got this and this never came through for you. Listen, Cindy Jacobs, one of the greatest prophets of the time, she's in Peter Wagner's whole kind of sitting on the board of directors, and she's written so many books. You can go read her books. Cindy Jacobs turned around as a prophet, and she said, do you know that there are prophetic words? She said this just a month ago or so in one of the conferences she was at. She said, you know, and she's a prophet, a renowned prophet. She said, there are prophetic words on my life that have not come to pass for 20 years. I could have lived in that space. And I could have moved out of my thinking in the Lord. And I could have moved into conforming to the pattern of this world, which I'm now paraphrasing, into the pattern of this world. And I could have gone down the wrong road. And I could have allowed it to take me out of the race. And I could have allowed Satan to take me out. And where would I be today? Because there are so many prophetic words that have come to pass in my life. And those are the ones that I've stood upon. And that's why she stands there today as an advocate of the Most High God. And she stands there today as an encourager of the faith. And as one that brings an awakening when she prophesies. So she's being used for the glory of God to stir the hearts of the people of God. Of course, Satan wants to take her out. Because look how many people's lives have been transformed through her ministry. So what about you? What is your ministry? Where are you placed in the body of Christ? Have you really, you know, if you want to be a winner, let me ask you this. Have you really been one that's allowed God to transform your thinking, or have you let the devil turn you in circles instead of you turning things around? Because you can't keep going on like that year after year, standing or sitting and saying, oh, we agree with the apostle, we agree with the prophet, we agree with the leaders, we agree with the word of God, more importantly than anything. We agree with the word.
Amen.
Oh, yes, amen, hallelujah. Praise God, hallelujah. Oh, rabba, shut up. Oh, hey, ha, ke, oh, rabba, shandaka. But then we go like this. I leave the church. And I allow my thinking to conform to the pattern of the world. And I allow my mind to be dictated to by spiritual forces that are not of God. And I call it just this and just that. And I give it medical names and all of that. And I don't allow the healing power and grace of God upon my life. And I don't allow my mind to be transformed. Then you might as well stay in the place that Elijah did. But he didn't stay there. He became a major, major prophet of the Lord. And he continued to finish his race. And he was taken up in a whirlwind. One of the two that never died before he was taken up. Because he was faithful. Friends, faithfulness doesn't come easy. It does come at a price. Ask me. If I didn't dye my hair, you'd see a lot of gray hair. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's in fashion in heaven. Although I'm sure we're going to be the 50s, the new 30, right? So in heaven, I'm sure it's going to be the new 20, right? Because we don't age and we'll have new bodies and everything. But here's the thing. God wants you to be healthy, not just in your spirit where you're shouting amen, but your mind must be transformed. That sermon I gave at Sozo wasn't just because I needed to have another message. I gave it because it was from the Holy Spirit. And whenever we move at the launching pad for our conferences, is always that God is giving us a word for what is to come. preparing our hearts. That's why we say, encourage you to take notes so you can go and meditate on the word, and you can also make sure that I'm speaking truth, right? So they take this fruit and they go, the fruit is like... the fruit is amazing! Turn around and give someone a high five and say, the fruit's good. Now tell somebody else, are you going after it? Ask them to give you an answer.
Are you going after it?
You've now committed, right? Amen. So they say the fruit is good, they look at it, and all of a sudden, so there's this, yes, 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 and then all of a sudden their minds kick in, and fear takes over. And it begins to swamp their minds to the point where they are absolutely petrified to go back into the land. Why? Because their thinking became conformed to the pattern of the world again. They saw the glory of the Lord. They saw that everything God had prophesied to them and promised them was in the land as God said it was. If they had believed God and they had obeyed God, they would have walked into the land there and then, but they didn't. The only two that did was Joshua and Caleb because they had a different spirit. We are living in a season right now, friends, where I'm telling you the only way we can turn things around in our lives is if we take on the spirit of Joshua and Caleb. In other words, we have a different spirit that no matter what comes at us, it causes us to rise up and stand firmer. You don't have to be some strong person to do that. You just have to be one that believes in the word of God. You need to, you know, friends, I can tell you that if I did a survey right now over the houses of God, and I said to you, how many minutes do you spend reading your word a day? If people were really honest, there would be many, many people that don't even pick this up. The most basic thing you can do as a Christian is read this word because it is the encourager. It is how you learn about the character of God, not just on the pulpit. Otherwise, you'll continue to be spoon-fed and you'll never, ever grow into that place of maturity. If you can't in your own prayer closet do and walk in this word and in your prayer life to grow what God wants to do in you. And you know, whenever people struggle with that, I always say, well, what do you think is hindering you? Because then there's some gremlins. We just need to get them thrown out of that closet so that your mind is not tormented or clouded by the stuff in the world. Amen? And often that's a great fear of people, to even go there, to even say, well, are there really any issues? Because those are the issues that the enemy will use at the opportune time. Those are the things that the enemy will take, those little strongholds, those little fears in your life at the opportune time. That's when he'll come and he'll try and pull those out. But you've got to be in a position where you say, my mind is transformed and I am turning this around, and no matter what the devil meant for me for bad, God said,
amen.
God said, it is written, you will worship the Lord your God, Satan. It is written. Do you know, saints, what is written? You need to have on your lips what is written. You need to have the scripture in your spirit, because it's at those times when you are feeling down and you are moved into that place that you will recall to mind, it is written. Amen. It is written. And I believe the word above everything that comes from that mouth that is the foul mouth. Amen? Yeah. And if you want to move into 2015 with turning it around in your life, and turning the things around in your life that for so many years, even you've heard so many sermons, you've been at so many services, but you're finding the same old, same old. It's time to transform. That's not an easy thing. It's a process. It's a process. How do you do it? You sit under the word. You come to church. You get regular. You get become a member. You become one that doesn't let the things of the same old things hinder you from doing what God has called you to do. You get involved as quickly as you can in the work of the Lord before the enemy tries to pull you out. You don't let those things that have plagued your mind weigh you down to the point where they actually dictate your decision making. When the enemy comes to you and says, listen, you're going to go broke and there's nothing that's going to be able to pull you out of it. You go, listen, I'm turning it around by the power and grace of the Most High God. That there is nothing that can stop me doing what God has said. For the word of God does not go void. It shall return and accomplish its purpose, the word says. Friends, I just want to say to you this morning that the thing with Joshua and Caleb, how they made it into the promised land, how you will make it into your promised land, is not just by believing the fruit is good, but by taking steps forward to move into the land without fear. Not letting the fears of this world overtake you. Not letting your fears rule your thinking, but saying, I'm letting the word permeate my being. I want there to be a purity of God's word that saturates my soul to the point where that is what dominates in my spirit, that my flesh is ruled by my spirit, not the other way around. Your flesh will continue to rule so long as your mind is not transformed. And that means it will keep you from the word. It will keep you from being consistent at church. It will keep you from everything except worrying. The only thing consistent will be your constant worry about what you shouldn't be worrying about. So I want to move into 2015 in power. And I believe the secret is what God has set us. As for me and my household, come what may, we will serve the Lord. You know, Prophet and I, many of you know, we've been through a lot this December. We went through, you know, for some of you maybe that don't have animals, I don't know, maybe you won't understand. But for us, our animals are like our children. And in December, we had to put two of our animals down. It was a terrible time. On Christmas Day, it was terrible. We think that our 10-year-old boxer, Holly, who was the most gentle, beautiful dog, we think that she had brain cancer, but we didn't, you know, a dog can't talk and there was no physiological signs, but behaviorally, she suddenly just became a different dog. And she just, it was just that kind of situation, and she attacked our smaller dog, our little dog, Chelsea, the younger of the two, for no rhyme or reason. It was a terrible experience. We got bruised and battered in the fight trying to pull it away. Trudy was here from Agalia visiting with us in our home, and she sees us. I'm like the pastor's kids again. But they would have killed each other if we weren't there. That's how bad it was. And she's a gentle dog. And here we had to take our baby and just, you know, make a decision that was the hardest decision we've ever had to make. And we could have gone, we could have said, oh, you know, Lord, how can you do this to me? I've been such a faithful servant for 23 years, Lord. I've done everything you've asked, Lord. How can you do this to me? And I could have walked away, we could have walked away, downcast, and pulled apart. And some other things also happened in December, but, you know, a couple of things at once. And we were like, this can't be happening. So of course we were in shock, and of course our emotions were affected, and of course we wept and we cried and we went through all the normal things that anyone would go through. But we didn't conform to the pattern of this world. When we got into that place, what we did was we looked up above the threshold into the heavenly realm. And we said, Lord, you would never allow this unless you knew what was going on. It could have been worse. Maybe it could have cost thousands and thousands and thousands of rands that we didn't have later on, or been a huge distraction in the middle of me being in a trip or something. And there's so many things that could have happened. We don't even know. But we had to trust that God, the God of grace and mercy, the God whose love endures forever, because I know the character of my God. The God of mercy and grace, because the mind must be transformed. So yes, we grieved. Yes, we sad and all of those things, but we did not let it dictate or distract us from the purposes. It might have held us back a little bit here and there, but you can't let the things of the world stop the plan of God, or stop you reaching the finish line, or stop you reaching what God has for you. And you also cannot let your fears dictate to you anymore. As you move into 2015, listen, the flesh is such a lazy thing. Listen to me. The flesh likes you to sit and think and torment and not move, do nothing. That's the flesh. It makes you, your mind work overtime, and the conforming to the world, it makes your mind work overtime, but you do nothing. You have no use to anyone, including yourself. Are you hearing me? And all you do is think less and less of yourself. That's the flesh. That's the mindset of the world. That's the old. That's the renewed mind takes a stand and says, listen, yes, all of these things are going on in my life. Yes, they're real. Yes, it's happening. But I'm not going to let those things stop me from, hang on, let me quickly get back. What was the vision? Let me get my prophecies out. Let me read what God has said. Let me get around people that can encourage me. Let me get people on the phone that can begin to pray for me, because I'm about to turn it around. Whatever the devil meant for bad, I'm going to turn it around, because as for me and my household, we're going to serve the Lord no matter what may come in my way. I'm going to serve the Lord. The enemy can give you the biggest Job experience, but as you go through each one, you're going to say, as for me and my household, I've got stronger. We're going to serve the Lord. God is looking for people with a different spirit. A spirit that doesn't just look at the fruit and say it's good, but a spirit that says, I'm hungry enough to do whatever it takes to get into the land. I'm hungry enough to do whatever it takes to get into the land. I'm not just going to look at the fruit and smell it and go, it's so good, and do nothing about it. I'm going to move into a place of maturity. Transformed thinking. I want the spirit of a renewed mind. The spirit of a renewed mind will not just make you smell the fruit, it will make you bear the fruit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Do you know what Joshua means? It means Yahweh is our deliverer. It means Savior. And I want to say to you this morning, are you one that is standing there and saying, you know what? No matter what the devil has thrown at me this year, as for me and my household, we're going to serve the Lord. Do you know what that means? It means you taking an active position in your household to say, it doesn't matter what. Even if my partner's not ready, even if my spouse is not ready, my husband, my wife, my partner, whatever, I'm going to stand for the Lord and everything, and I'm going to even stand for my household until they're ready. Hallelujah. And I'm just going to stand, Lord, no matter what may come my way, no matter what hits me, no matter what turmoil, and I'm going to say, as for me, I will serve the Lord. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. That's the spirit of Joshua and Caleb. That's the spirit that will get you to the finish line. That's the spirit that no matter what happens, you will enter the promised land and the promises that God, you will see the promises of God for your life. Are you with me? That's why so many people, I believe, have gone through so much difficulty in this 2014 so that we could come out of it stronger, more faithful. Are you with me? Come on, friends. Come on, let's give the Lord an amen or a shout or something. Bringing us out of captivity into the land of plenty. All the prophets are talking about the amazing things that are due to happen in 2015. Now you can look back at 2014 at all the bad things, or you can look back at 2014 and say, sure, look at what God did for me there, and there. Instead of looking, our natural inclination is to always look at the bad. Human beings, our natural inclination is to see the worst before we see the best. Even when it comes to people, right? We see the worst before the best. Distortions of our minds and our sin, we see the worst before we see the best. Hallelujah. That person looked at me funny. I wonder why. What did I do wrong? Amen. When actually, no, maybe they were in a heavy depression and they weren't actually looking at you. They were just staring blankly because of their own issues. That's how hung up we all are. How many of you know we need some healing in the body of Christ? Isn't that true? That's why we encourage Matthew 18, that people don't close up, that we talk about our issues. If you've got any beef with anybody, you talk. You get it out in the open so Satan doesn't have reign over your mind, friends. Amen? It's good. The fruit is good, and the land of plenty awaits those of us. And it's not just heaven. It's right here on earth. The promises and the blessings God has are for now. Amen? Yeah. Amen. Spirit break out. I just feel that we need to really pray. How many of you say, you know what, I've been so doused with sand in the last year that it feels like my fire's been put out completely, and I want things to turn around, and I want my mind to be turned around. Amen. And so you're going to come up here this morning and say, listen, Lord, I want a fresh fire to be released over my life. I want to impart to you this morning a fresh fire, a fresh faith that will not just see the fruit, not just smell the fruit, not just touch the fruit, but that you will be so moved by the fruit that you will run into the promised land. Hallelujah. And take it. Because here's what Joshua said in Caleb. Caleb said, listen, surely we can take possession of the land. Half our fight in the spirit realm is about possession. Let's take possession of that land this morning. Amen. So how many are ready to say, listen, I just want to release any heaviness over my life. I want to release those things off my life. And I want my prayer to be that God stand with me, transforms my mind. Those of you that can stand, and if you've got sickness in your body or anything, come up, just whisper it in my ears. We're going to quickly pray. This is not going to be a long ministry session here. I just want to impart to you quickly, and you want to trust when you come and stand up here, that when you stand here, Holy Spirit is upon you. Holy Spirit's going to impart to you, and your mind will be transformed and renewed as you pray and read the word and sit under the word on a Sunday and a Thursday and whenever you come into ministry. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor, I'm turning it around. Tell someone else, I'm finishing the race. Tell someone else, my time is now. I'm not finished the race. And I'm getting to the finish line. I'm not letting anything stop me. Come on, come on. I'm not letting anything stop me. Hallelujah. So don't look around you at the crowds and all of that. Look in front of you. Get past the threshold. Get focused on what God has for you. Get into times of deep prayer with the Lord. Spend much longer than you've ever spent in prayer. And if that doesn't change your thinking, nothing will. Hallelujah. You know what I'm saying? Praise God. So as we sing this song, I want you to come up. If you're saying, listen, I want to move into 2015, I want to turn it around, every financial struggle that I've had, every emotional upheaval, everything that the enemy has thrown in my path this year, I am turning it. I declare right now, I am turning it around. Say it after three. I declare. I am turning it around. As of today. As for me and my household. We will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. Today all heartache goes. Financial pressure goes. Emotional struggle goes. Job struggle goes. Study struggle goes. And I embrace today all that God has for me in the land. I've tasted the fruit, and I know that it's good. And now, Lord, I'm walking towards it in faith, and I'm taking possession of the land that you promised. Hallelujah! Come on! So you quickly come and line up here. I'm going to impart this fire of God over you. Get ready. God is about to move in great power. Come on, right now, in Jesus' name.
Heaven, come down. Spirit, break. Spirit, break out.
We hope you have been blessed by this message. Join Pastor Deborah next week for another exciting word. Spirit.